All right. So, microservices. What's the big deal? Microservices are like a box of mini pizzas. Each slice is its own thing, independent, self-contained, and if one fails, the rest are good to go. These little services can talk to each other, but they don't rely on one big central chunk. Now, why are non-blocking or reactive patterns important here? Think of it like a drive-thru. You place your order, then drive ahead while someone else places theirs. Everyone keeps moving. That's reactive. The old way, it's like waiting at a counter until your burger's done before they even take the next order. Slow and frustrating. Reactive programming basics. Okay, reactive programming. Sounds fancy, right? It's like when you are at a restaurant and tell the waiter, "Hey, let me know when my food's ready." That's reactive programming. You are not blocking the waiter's time while they deal with your order. Non-blocking means no one is wasting time waiting around. In technical terms, it's about streams of data. You've got reactive streams that act like a conveyor belt, constantly delivering chunks of data. Then there is mono, like a single dish, and flux, a buffet of multiple items. You just react to what's being delivered. Benefit of reactive microservices. So why reactive microservices are worth the hype? First, scalability. Your app handles a ton of requests like a pro because no one's standing in line waiting. Perfect for big apps with millions of users. Second, performance. By not blocking threads, you are making the most of your resources. Now where does reactive really shine? Real-time apps. Think chat apps, live dashboards, or stock tickers. Anywhere, users expect instant feedback. If your app needs a stream of data or handle lots of requests at once, use the reactive paradigm. But hey, not every app needs it. If you are building a tiny to-do list app for yourself, stick with the simpler blocking stuff. But if you are going big, reactive microservices with Spring Boot and WebFlux are the way to go. Spring Boot and Reactive Stack. Spring WebFlux is built to handle those non-blocking, asynchronous reactive vibes. To set it up, start with a simple Spring Boot project, add the Spring Boot Starter WebFlux dependency, and you get your ticket to the reactive world. Instead of returning objects, you will return those mono or flux types from methods annotated with @rest controller. And don't forget web client for making API calls. It's the star of reactive programming. The best part? It's not complicated once you get the hang of it. Your app stays super responsive even under heavy loads, which is perfect for modern microservices. Difference between flux, mono, and backpressure. Let's come back to the technical terms. I know they might be confusing, especially if you hear them for the first time. Flux. Think of flux as a stream of zero to many elements. It's like a playlist where you can have multiple songs or even no songs at all. It's perfect when you are dealing with a collection of items, such as querying multiple records from a database or streaming a series of events. Mono. Mono represents a stream of zero to one element. It's like a single email. Either you get one or you don't. You'd use mono when you are fetching a single object or result, like fetching user details by ID. Backpressure. Backpressure is about controlling the flow of data between producers, the source, and consumers, the handler. Imagine someone pouring water into a glass. If the flow is too fast, the glass overflows. Backpressure is a way to avoid that overflow by controlling how much data is requested or processed at a time. It's crucial in reactive programming to ensure that the consumer isn't overwhelmed by too much data from the producer. Are Mono and Flux used only with WebFlux? No. Flux and Mono are part of Project Reactive, which is the reactive library that WebFlux uses under the hood. You can use them in any Java application, not just WebFlux. For example, building reactive CLI tools, processing streams of data from files or databases. RxJava in the Java world. If you've already worked with reactive programming on the client side, I'm sure you have some questions on your mind. Maybe you have used the React programming library RxJS on the client side, and you know that there is a similar one for Java, RxJava. So why aren't we talking about it? Yes, RxJava is another popular library for reactive programming in Java, similar to RxJS in the JavaScript world. Here is how they stack up. RxJava inspired by ReactiveX principles. It provides observable, single, completable, etc., which are similar to Flux and Mono in Reactor. RxJS is the JavaScript equivalent for RxJava, widely used in front-end frameworks like Angular for managing reactive streams. While RxJava was one of the first libraries for reactive programming in Java, Project Reactor became the go-to choice for Spring applications because it's natively integrated with Spring Boot and WebFlux. So RxJava and Project Reactor are conceptually similar, but their APIs differ slightly. Backend versus front-end reactive programming. Libraries like RxJS and Project Reactor are cousins. They share the same DNA, just applied in their respective domains. But if you are comfortable with one, it's easier to grasp the other. Similarity. Both are stream-based, both in the backend, Reactive Spring, and frontend in React, Angular, or Svelte. Reactive programming is about dealing with data streams. Both are event-driven. Both rely on reacting to events, like user input, API responses, or database updates. They are non-blocking. Reactive programming ensures that you don't block threads while waiting for data, whether it's a backend HTTP request or a front-end button click. Differences. When it comes to data sources, in the backend, like Reactive Spring, reactive programming handles stream of APIs, databases, or message queues. In the front-end, reactive programming deals with streams from user interactions, DOM events, or WebSockets. When it comes to purpose, the backend focuses on optimizing server-side performance and scalability. But the front-end manages UI responsiveness and real-time updates. When it comes to concurrency model, the backend is thread-efficient. It works with non-blocking input-output for heavy loads. The front-end runs in a single-threaded environment, which is the JavaScript runtime. When it comes to libraries and frameworks, in the backend with Reactive Spring, we have Project Reactor, RxJava, and WebFlux. In the front-end, we have RxJS, which is used with Angular, and state management with Redux. When it comes to the implementation complexity, the backend is more complex. We are handling Backpressure and thread models. The front-end reactive programming is much simpler, as the JavaScript runtime handles much of the async flow. Takeaway. Reactive programming principles are universal, but their application differ. On the front-end, it's about managing user interactions, animations, and real-time updates seamlessly. On the back-end, it's about handling massive concurrent streams and data efficiently. Reactive patterns make microservices scalable and smooth. Your app can handle tons of requests without getting stuck. This is perfect for real-time updates, streaming data, and users who hate waiting. So how is this different from the old-school blocking way? In the past, we used REST template, which is like standing in line at a cashier. You are stuck there until your turn is over. Web client, the reactive alternative, lets you place your order and go check Instagram until it's ready. Now go check my other videos until you get notified about the next one, which is about building reactive microservice with Spring WebFlux. If you are excited about diving deeper into the world of modern software engineering from architecture to cloud and security, check out my video courses where I explore these concepts further and tackle real-world challenges. The link to the courses is in the video description below. See you next time.